Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. It is the end of Nicolas Cage week. We are on our third film, and we are on a film called Kill Chain.
Kill Chain.
Kill Chain. I couldn't remember the name of this movie. I kept forgetting it as I was watching it. I was like,
Kill Chain. Me too. But was I going crazy, or was this movie pretty good? Show all my cool and cold night vultures.
It was decent.
Maybe was it just because I had just watched Jujitsu and then went straight into this movie?
I think it hovered right around a 3 out of 5.
Yeah.
But this is definitely better than Jujitsu and Outcast.
Well,
now, Outcast had the biggest budget.
Yeah.
But this film, I felt like had the most potential. Like somebody actually had an idea.
Yeah.
And they put the idea together. I think it was done, not done in the highest level. It was done pretty low level budget wise and some of the acting wise and some of the stuff, how it ended up. But I do feel like it had, an idea. And I want to point out, so right at the beginning of the movie, Cage is in this hotel. He's running it. He's got a dyed black beard. He's got this seriously like dark hair. His beard is like super black. His hair is super dark.
And trivia, he wanted a mustache for this movie and he argued for a mustache and they said, no, you need to have a beard.
That's bull crap. So. That's bull. That's all. Yeah. Cause
well, if you're bringing Cage in for your central character, you got to trust Cage for what he needs.
Yeah.
You think when Cage went to the director of Outcast and said, I want snakes on my wrist, the director was like, no, that doesn't make sense.
No, he's like, let's get
he was like, oh, we're going to get snakes and we got to get him on this guy's wrist. He knows what he's doing. So anyway.
He probably said, I want one snake. And they were like, get this man two. Get this man on a snake on each wrist. Yeah. He's in his hotel and these two guys show up and you're like, these guys are shady. These guys are obviously like goons that are showing up, the obvious goons. And they show up and they're immediately like, what's up, man? You're like, something's weird here. Right. Someone's weird. Like there's some guy laying on a table with his head down. He doesn't look right. Cage is kind of like, hey, you know, what, like, you know, what's up, guys? And it's got decent, it's actually pretty decent dialogue going on where Cage is kind of making some jokes and the guy shows us, he's like, hey, man, what do you got under there? And Cage shows he's got a gun. Mm-hmm. And it cuts upstairs and you see a woman who's covered in blood kind of looking and you're like, who's that? And the other guy's like, basically like pulls his shotgun out and is like, you know, basically we're going to kill you. And the Cage is like, I got a story to tell you. And I was like, okay, this is kind of weird. But then, so it goes from that opening, which I was like, cool. Then it cuts to an opening of a TV show. I don't know what the opening was. All of a sudden it's like, and it plays this opening for like, I'm like, was this originally a TV pilot? Well, then there must be some magic clue inside this gentle. Because the opening doesn't feel like the rest of the movie. The movie.
No. Yeah. I don't know if it was just someone's idea or the producers were like, we need something here to spice things up. Or I don't really know what the thought process was.
What spice was that? It looked from something from old USA Network in the beginning, and I couldn't figure it out. I was like, when it was going, I was like, uh-oh, what is happening here? So it does this opening, and then it cuts back. So you're like, and now you're under the impression at the beginning of this is Cage's story. Right.
Yeah. That's what I was
like. Oh, this is his story. Right. Which then I started having questions up real quick. So I started going like, no, something else is here. But the dad from Veronica Mars, if anybody's watched Veronica Mars, he is living in this. Well, basically, you don't know what he's in, but it looks like this kind of rundown motel or apartment or whatever. And he's there talking to his daughter. And you can tell right from the beginning, I'm like, I can tell this is low budget. Just the way it's shot. It looks like one of those rooms that Seagal's killed 30 people in. Very nondescript. It's like, oh, it's kind of dirty, and you can tell it's probably on a set. But he's on there and he's talking to his daughter and he's like making amends. And while he's doing this, he's like setting up his gun. He's setting up all the stuff, and he's like, oh, okay, he's about to snipe somebody. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, okay, this is kind of interesting. It's not high level, but he's about to snipe somebody. And then it kind of again, not super well done, but interesting that as he gets ready, he's watching this car and he's getting ready to snipe. He looks over and there's another sniper. And he's like, what the frick? And I was like, okay, this is interesting. Like,
and then he calls that prostitute up, right?
Calls the prostitute up to be able to look. So she gets to know what's going on. She sends a prostitute over to talk to that guy. That, and then he's talking to the guy that hired him, right?
Yeah.
He's talking to the Veronica, and the guy, then he finds, realizes real quickly, like, oh, the guy that hired me is hired someone to take me out.
Yeah.
So that guy that's over that's going to take him out, slits the throat of the hooker and starts shooting at the Veronica Mars dad. That guy's trying to survive. He puts a bed up. He gets shot a bunch. He falls underneath a bed, like under a mattress. They don't show him. So I'm like, I don't think he's dead. But then that guy runs off, gets a phone
call. The guy who killed Veronica
Mars. He runs off. He's like, did the job. He calls the guy that hired him. And he's like, this guy did blah, blah, blah. And the guy's like, go to this burned down car, basically. The money's in there. You'll be able, you know, all this different stuff and ask questions. So he goes in there and he finds a bunch of diamonds. Mm-hmm. Immediately around the corner come two cops.
Yeah. And now these two cops, they immediately start like beating him up and they throw him into the thing. And they, now, were they tipped off?
Yeah. So he goes, who told you about me? Who tipped you off? Right. He knew somebody turned him in, like immediately set it up for him to be captured.
Snitches end up in ditches.
So these guys capture him, and then he immediately starts trying to play mind games with them, which I didn't buy because he's immediately like talking to the one guy, and he's like, he's just going to take the money from you and leave. The other guy's like, shut up, and he keeps punching the dude.
Yeah.
And it gets to the point, which was cool, where all of a sudden that one guy finally has enough and just shoots him in the head.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, geez. But then I didn't buy, even though it was an okay scene, I didn't buy that those two guys were going to turn on each other so easily. Like, then one guy's just like, forget this. And they start shooting at each other through that grate in the car.
Which I actually like that scene because it almost came across, like, realistic in that they just kept blindly shooting and never hitting anything. like, they just keep reaching up and shooting over and over again. And then, and then eventually the one guy gets out of the car and is under the car and waiting for the other guy to step out to shoot him. And the other guy's feet hit the ground and he shoots him, but it turns out it was the dead body and it was a decoy. And so the white guy lives. Classic.
In my mind, he said something like he sinks down and he's like, see in hell or something like that. And I was
that scene to me wasn't, it wasn't it wasn't a masterclass in cinema or something, but it was short enough. It got to the point. It was enjoyable. Where the earlier scene I thought was just as well done, except it was just
too long.
It just kept going.
Well, yeah. So the guy leaves, and then he goes and meets his girlfriend.
Yep, he meets his girlfriend, and his girlfriend seems just as awful as he is because she's like, "Well, you killed him for me. We got the diamonds." She's like, and then the guy's like, "We have to meet." How do you pronounce the spider in Spanish? What is
it? Yeah, I can't pronounce the name.
I don't remember, but they're like, we have to meet him at this hotel. And then at that time, these other people show up who are out to kill this lady, right?
Yeah.
And the man, and they want the diamonds themselves.
Yeah. So this woman who's like kind of like a head gangster person.
Yeah.
My name is Taz and I'm 13 years old. I do what I want, when I want, and how I want to do it. Can't nobody tell me what to do.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. She's like it's like this gang thing. So they're after them now and they're chasing them. The woman and the man are trying to get to, do you remember her name? The woman's name?
No, I do not remember the name.
It's like a central character in this movie.
And yeah, I can't. The names, trying to remember a lot of these names sounds irrelevant a lot of times with what they're trying to do.
Yeah, so her boyfriend or the guy who brought the diamonds, he ends up getting killed. But anyway, so she gets to this hotel, and it's called, what's the hotel called?
The Nest.
No, it's the guy's name. It's the guy who used to own it.
Yeah, the guy that Cage. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, do we see that sign in the opening?
I don't think so.
Okay. Because the guy is on that corner, right? The guy who Veronica Mars' dad is in that hotel, right?
Yeah. And I think that's one of the big reveals at the end that he was up.
Yeah.
There. Yeah.
But it shows a lot of exterior shots. And I couldn't remember if we had realized that.
I think it was always to the side where his window was. So you didn't quite know. So when it finally went up there, it was like, oh, yeah. This is actually up in this room.
Yeah. Okay, so I just wanted to, but yeah.
But she shows up to Cage, and you know, she goes up there to get a room, and Cage is like, "Look, I won this game, like on basically on a poker
hotel game,
hotel. Okay. I won the hotel. I run it. Doesn't make me much money. Let's have a drink." And he ends up, he's talking to her, and she's just like, "Oh, you used to be somebody, obviously, right? Like you used to be like a killer, a bad guy, or all this different stuff." And then I can't remember how, but Cage suddenly goes upstairs and then just starts making out with her.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Kind of out of like, I couldn't even, and like, it didn't even fit in any context. All of a sudden Cage goes up and I'm like, huh?
And this is the thing is the movie. I feel like verges on, like we talked about, like actually being good in the sense that I can't tell how aware it is that they mention multiple times later in the movie, people will say, "Did she sleep with you?" She's talking to Cage. "Did she sleep with you?" Because she will. She'll sleep with you and all this stuff, right? Well, yeah. Cage seems to know that from the beginning, and he seems to be a terrible person. And it seems like right from the beginning, he knows she's in trouble. She's paying in cash, which she's not supposed to do. She has a ton of money. And so he seems to immediately just abuse that situation and go, "I can sleep with her."
Yeah.
I mean, that's, and I assume that's what's going on. It's just the movie doesn't seem that gritty or, the movie doesn't seem to get into that realm too much.
Cage's character is just kind of weird because his character is this person that's done a lot of these things, but then he doesn't quite play that character. So his character is really kind of defined in that way.
Yeah, because it should come across really rapey, and I felt like it did, but at the same time, I feel like it is rapey, but it was shot in a way that was supposed to be like, but they do feel a connection. But I'm like, when you're just looking at it objectively, you're like, there's no connection here. She's just in trouble and he knows he can sleep with her. And she knows she can sleep with people to get what she needs. And so it's just kind of like weird.
So she goes, he sees that this woman's coming to look for her. So Cage goes down and it's like, yeah, go up there. And he lets that woman go in. He talks to like a couple of her, like cops, like her thug guy that comes up, who's like threatening and put a gun to him and stuff. And he's like, "Let me make you a drink." And he's talking to that guy and stuff and poisons that guy. So that guy falls over dead.
Which was my first thought in that scene was when he's like, "Let me make you a drink." I was like, you would be afraid of poison, right? And then I just thought, well, it's so obvious. Obviously, they're not going to do that. And then he gets poisoned and dies.
Then he goes up. Here's that woman is like, you know, she's arguing and stuff and fighting with this other girl. And Kate comes up to like, you know, chill it out. Right? And this girl ends up like brutally stabbing the girl.
Yeah.
Like brutally stabbing her a bunch of times.
And this movie, that's where this movie kind of gets into that realm of like, pretty dark violence, and it's entertaining. I think it would have been it just needed it needed better cinematography and direction to really pull off like an action movie, because it never came across really like an action movie. Just came across like when they would kill people, it would just get pretty dark and violent. But at that point, she stabs this mob lady a ton of times, and then Cage is, you can see what now you start to get better sense of Cage's character, even though it always stays kind of weird, but you get the sense of he just kind of like looks at it and it's just like, well, roll her up in the bedspread and take her out to the van. And so you realize really like more so like this guy isn't affected by any of this.
So he does that, all that stuff. And then we cut back to that girl stabs everybody. She comes out, she's all bloody. He's got the guy dead on the table. And we go all the way back to the beginning where the goons show up and they're looking for all the stuff going on. And they're like, "We know who you are," and blah, 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 blah. Now this is where the movie, again, this one gets a bit confusing when it starts trying to put all the pieces together for what we watched. And it starts tying it in with the fact that Cage is the one that has set up all this in motion.
Yeah. So Cage is like, "Let me tell you a story. Stop me if you get bored." And so now he goes into the story, which isn't the movie.
Yeah.
Which you think kind of in the movie, you think that he's telling that story, but he's not. And he tells a story about how he was a hitman or whatever. And he worked with another guy and they got sent down to, do you remember what country it was? Was it Mexico?
They were getting cargo. They were running some of the cargo, but they didn't know what
it was. We get sent down there to bribe the government and let the cargo go through. And the government refuses to, or at least the police or whoever, refuse to play. And so they say, go in there and just burn the cargo down. Teach them a lesson. Basically make sure like They don't get the money and they don't get the cargo. Yeah. And when they open up the holding tank or whatever, where the cargo is, it's a bunch of little girls.
I love little girls. They make me feel so good.
And Cage can't do it. And he gets upset. And his partner takes one of the girls as his own daughter. Cage just flees with the money. The partner buys this hotel and runs it. And then we just get the scene about like the girls growing up and Cage is like a father figure to her. A lot of the stuff about like where you're just like, oh, this is a lot of movie that's just suddenly being poured into here. A lot of stuff I just don't believe.
Well, the thing is, all of this didn't have, for this to work fully, for this to be the reveal that I felt like fully worked and all the jigsaw puzzle came together, a lot of this needed to be hinted at more.
Yeah.
Through the film of what was going on, this whole thing about the girl that he's this father figure to, about the human trafficking, about the fact that then a guy, the one who accidentally... So at the beginning, the two guys are shooting at each other with the things. They actually burn all those extra girls.
I love little girls. They make me feel so good. I don't care if I'm a one-way mirror.
Yeah, he's the one that gets sent in to do the dirty work.
And he does. And the guy that was talking to his daughter, Veronica Mars' dad, he didn't do it. He didn't have a stomach for it, but he didn't stop it. He just stood there.
He gets into the drug business.
And as for drugs, well, drugs are bad. You shouldn't do drugs. Okay, that about wraps up my introduction. Now, are there any questions?
He's getting murdered by the mob, this lady who
got stabbed brutally bad.
That gets brutally stabbed. She, this lady is the one, ultimately the one that ends up calling the shot to kill that girl when she gets older. And they torture her and cut her up into pieces and leave her in a field. So Cage... His whole motive, apparently the whole movie, is to kill this lady who is the mob. I'm putting this together as I'm speaking, by the way.
Yeah. It was, I'm trying to figure it all out because I was like, maybe this is a movie you have to watch again, but I don't think all of it quite fits together. It's all cohesive.
I mean, she says, the main ladies, again, we should probably know names here because it'll probably make this a little less confusing, but.
Naming no names. I don't know any.
She says to Cage, she's like, this couldn't have been your original plan. Like this, you know, it worked out way too well. And he was like, well, no. And he kind of mentioned something about how like he planned something else. But anyway, so he's explaining all this to these two hitmen that are there to kill him. And basically they're just like, well, you tell us that you think that's enough for us to not kill you or something. And then we get the twist where he says, no, I was telling it for I'm talking to the other person in the room, or he says I'm telling it to somebody else. And you find out who he's actually telling this story to is that lady he slept with, who's been watching the whole time secretly. And she starts shooting those hitmen. Seems like there'd be a faster way to just tell her that story. It seems kind of crazy, but it's like, whatever, I'll deal with it. But then the shootout ensues there.
Yeah, so there's a whole shootout between them. It's pretty long. It's a pretty long shootout. Cage hits one, shoots the black guy, destroys him. The other guy's getting ready to do a big fight. He gets his throat slit. Stuff is, you know, it's pretty violent and everything. And basically, Cage walks away with what his whole thing was at the end. He goes up to his room and he realizes, oh, Veronica Mars' dad is up in his hotel doing the shots. He's still alive. Still, poor guy, still alive, suffering. And he just lets the guy know, like, you know, look, I planned this whole thing. You hired the guy to kill me, and you kind of put this whole thing in motion. And like Cage said, I had a plan A, a plan B, a plan C, everything to lead up to this thing to get everything that he wanted. And then he walks out of the bar, and at the end of this movie, this movie was heads above the other two films, the other Nicolas Cage, Jiu-Jitsu and Outcast. It was heads above, and it's a film that I think, could have been made much better with a possibility. And I could even see who made it going on with a bigger budget to make a decent good film.
Yeah.
Like I could see that. This is one of those movies that's what's obvious direct-to-video, but is above most direct-to-video films.
I love little girls. They make me feel so good. I love little girls. They make me feel
told me